And welcome back. I'm Mabel Jong. This is continuing coverage of the World Healthcare Congress here in Washington, D.C. This is our last day of coverage, and I'm so pleased to have in our studio Laurie Doran, Chief Financial Officer, BMC HealthNet Plan, WellSense Health Plan. Good to see you, Laurie.
I'm so happy to be here.
Yes.
And I also wanted to clarify that I am the former Chief Financial and Chief Customer Officer at BMC HealthNet Plan.
Yes.
And I'm really happy to be here to talk a little bit about my experience working at BMC HealthNet Plan to implement provider partnerships and to discuss a little bit about what we covered at our panel yesterday on Medicaid provider partnerships. So I was joined by Karen Love from Texas and Lisa Pruitt from here in Washington, D.C. And our panel talked about engaging providers and some of the challenges and some of the opportunities within that space. And the biggest learning that I got out of my session were the commonalities. We all struggled with having an adequate population size over which to do a value-based program. And we were all challenged by the benefits of standardization across programs that work with providers, so that providers aren't trying to work with, you know, six separate health plans and six separate programs, but accompanied by the fact that some of that flexibility is also beneficial, and you have to part with some of those opportunities in order to create a large enough population to do value-based contracting.
And what are the best ways to partner with providers to meet some of the goals that you've set?
Yeah, so Boston Medical Center HealthNet Plan is the insurance arm of the Boston Medical Center Healthcare Delivery and Finance Organization. Mm-hmm. So they approached provider partnerships as a collective, bringing their population health and their insurance resources to bear. And I think that all organizations do some flavor of that. The key attributes of our approach to providers included transparency, being very clear with providers where the opportunities were, what kinds of data we have to work with, very clear information on funds flow, and very clear directions on who does what. So that led to another, you know, core attribute of provider partnerships, which is a strong support model. And the goal that we had for our support model was working to ensure people were doing what they did best. So, ensuring that the providers were focusing on behavioral health integration, for example, and that the health plans were focused on actuarial rate evaluation, and that we weren't duplicating efforts.
Mm-hmm.
Another key attribute, which is very consistent with the partnership model, is ensuring that the providers are in the lead. In Massachusetts, the Medicaid program has been extremely clear that the ACO program needs to be provider-led.
Mm-hmm.
So all of the attributes of our partnership conversations and our programs need to keep that in mind. And then the last thing that I would say, which is kind of just pragmatic, is starting early. What we found is that the providers that we wound up partnering with most closely in the ACO framework, the new ACO framework, were providers that we had partnered with previously in different kinds of value-based purchasing contracts, and were those that we were speaking with very early in the process to just start the conversation about where the state was heading and how that may influence us.
And what are partners concerned about right now when you do have conversations about with them?
Yeah, so providers are very concerned about their patients. They're very concerned about model changes that can disrupt their patients and how you will address that. So although in Massachusetts they are on a 5-year program to demonstrate or to test the ACO model, we needed to, out of the gate, address things that would impact our members and our patients. Network, so ensuring that people had access to the providers that our ACOs were used to collaborating with, the specialists they were used to collaborating with, that people understood the operational requirements. You know, what does the prior auth process look like? What should we really be doing in the care management space? And trying to do as much as we could to integrate data early. Again, there's five years to, you know, to improve things and to and to modify models and to hopefully perfect them. But out of the gate, the providers were very concerned that they had a good, solid foundation to take care of their patients. And then I would be remiss if I didn't mention concern about financial viability. One of the big benefits of Medicaid reform in Massachusetts, is that it brought significant DSRIP funding to bear. And the providers want to ensure that that funding is used appropriately and that the programs that they put in place with that funding are sustainable.
Okay. Wow. A lot did come out of the session and of your time here, Amy. How did you find the conference in general?
I really enjoyed the conference. I liked the fact that there were so many different tracks. So I was able to, you know, to focus on Medicaid, obviously, because that's where I spend a lot of my time. But I also went to a session in the healthcare investment track, and I went to a session in the social determinants track, which I really enjoyed. There are a lot of people here, and there are a lot of good opportunities for, you know, conversation and networking as well.
All right, Laurie, thank you so much for your time and for stopping by.
Thank you so much for having me.
And I'm Mabel Jong. We have two more interviews, so stay with us. We'll be right back.